أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة يا مظلوم يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قال الذين يظنون أنهم ملاقو الله كم من فئة قليلة غلبت فئة كثيرة بإذن الله والله مع الصابرين صل على محمد وآل محمد A second for the love of Imams al-Hasan wal-Husayn. A third for the love of Fatima al-Zahra with your loudest voices. In our everyday lives, people seem to favor quality over quantity. Meaning, they choose what is more efficient, what is more practical, what is more useful for them, rather than just plain numbers. Sometimes, more is not better. It's about the quality of things. The things that we have in life, the things that we need, the things that we use. Quantity is not necessarily a good thing. People usually look for quality. For example, would you rather have three cheap cars, each one values $3,000, $4,000, but there are three, and they're old, they're used, you know, they could stop at any minute on the freeway. Or you would rather have one car brand new, more expensive, obviously, but it's more efficient. At the end of the day, you need one car that will take you to places. Having three cars won't help that much. You need a car that will take you to work, that will take you out with your family. In the winter, it has a heater. In the spring, in the summer, it has air conditioning. It takes you to places. Thus, most people would prefer to have one good car rather than, it might be expensive, rather than having three cars or four cars, but they're not all expensive. More is not better. Also, would you rather have three homes that are, you know, not overly priced, two bedrooms each, in not so good of a neighborhood, or have one home, five bedroom, in a good area, in a good neighborhood? It might have a pool in it, might have a nice view. Which one would you rather have? One house, one home, or three homes? Obviously, you choose one home. That's better, has better more bedrooms, might be more expensive, but all you need is one. You don't need three homes, unless you have three wives. Then that's another story. Of course, I'm not encouraging anyone to have three wives. As, you know, that wise man once said, and we believe in one Allah, one Qibla, one Quran, and one wife. No more than that. You would rather have one instead of having three, because all you need is one. If you were given a week vacation, you could go whatever you'd like. You have the option of touring Europe within an entire week. Within an entire week, you would tour the whole continent of Europe. That means you have maybe, you know, 10 hours in each country, no more. Or you'd spend that entire week in one country, like France, for example. Which one would you rather do? See all of the countries, see more? You know, you'd be able to come back home and say that you saw all of Europe within 1 week. Or you choose one country for an entire week and enjoy it. Enjoy France, for example. The beauty of France, southern France. Which one would you rather choose? Of course, most people would choose to go to one country for an entire week and see that entire country. Because it's about what? It's about quality, it's not about quantity. Thus, in our day-to-day lives, we choose quality over quantity. We choose that is what is more practical, what is more efficient, what is more useful. Plain numbers don't really benefit us. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, in Islam, does Islam look for quality or quantity? Some might say, you know, according to my reading of Islam, according to what I've heard, Islam is all about quantity. Islam is not about quality. Islam is about numbers. The more the merrier, the more the better. Really? They say yes. We'll give you a bunch of examples. One, we believe in Islam there's 124,000 prophets. 124,000. Allah didn't send one or two or three, not even 100, not even 200, not even 1,000. 124,000 prophets, while he could have just sent one. So that says that Islam is about Islam is about quantity, not quality. The answer is that you've misunderstood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent 124,000 prophets, not for the sake of numbers, not because of quantity. No, but because previously transportation was very rare, very difficult. There were no planes, no trains, no cars, not even bicycles. There was no internet. You know, there was no Facebook or Twitter. Transportation was difficult. Communication was difficult. Thus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to send a prophet to every single city. Perhaps every single village. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the Quran, and the Quran speaks of villages. وَتِلْكَ الْقُرَىٰ And those villages. To every single village, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send a prophet, would send a messenger. Why? Because transportation was impossible. You can't have a prophet that would move from one country to another, from one continent to another. That was just not possible. Thus, for all the various countries, for all the various civilizations, for all the various cultures, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needed to send a prophet, a messenger. So it's not about quantity. Allah just wants to send 124,000 prophets because he had nothing else to do. He was looking for numbers. No. That is one. Two, they were not sent all at the same time. The 124,000 prophets were not sent in the same year or in the same month. We're talking about thousands of years. A period of thousands of years, these prophets were being sent one after the other. And remember that a lot of these prophets were killed. They were massacred. According to some narrations by Ahlul Bayt, that Bani Israel killed between dawn and sunrise, which is how much? About an hour and 15 minutes, an hour and 20 minutes maximum, an hour and a half. Bani Israel, every day between dawn and sunrise, between Fajr and sunrise, they would kill 70 prophets. Every day. They were being massacred. And keeping in consideration that they were not all sent at the same time, we needed 124,000 prophets. So it's not about quantity that in Islam we look for quantity. No. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Another thing some people might misunderstand is the daily prayers, the amount of prayers that we have. They say we have in Islam the 5 daily prayers. That's 17 units. These are mandatory. These are an obligation. In addition to that, we have 31 recommended units, correct? The mustahabbat, the nawafil, the recommended prayers to pray before the morning prayer and before dhuhr and asr and after maghrib and after isha and the 11 units of salat al-layl. We have 31 or 34 recommended units that adds up to 51 units a day. 17 are recommended, 17 are mandatory and 34 are recommended. That's 51 units. That's quantity. That's a lot. That's a big quantity of prayers every day. And we have a hadith that say, As-salatu khayru mawdu'. Salah is the best thing that you could do. الصلاة خير موضوع فمن شاء استقل ومن شاء استكثر. Whoever wishes to pray less, or if you'd like to pray more, that's up to you. That's up to you. Meaning Islam looks for quality. Islam looks for quantity. The more you pray, the better. The more, the merrier. On Laylatul Qadr, there is 100 units. 100 rak'ah. On Laylatul Qadr. That means more is better. Quantity is better in Islam. This is also not correct. Yes, we do have 51 units, but don't misunderstand it. We do have the 17 mandatory units every day, the 5 daily prayers, and we have the recommended prayers. But this depends on your, let's say, your spiritual appetite. How much can you handle? How much are you craving? Depends on you. That is why 17 of them are mandatory. The rest are recommended, depending on you, depending on your mood, depending on your spiritual appetite. How much would you like to pray? How spiritual do you feel today? How thankful do you feel today? That's up to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves you room for you to decide. Depending on your mood, how much you like to do. It's like working out. You know, some days you're in the mood to work out for an hour. Other days you'll work out for 5 minutes. And other days you don't work out at all. It depends on how much energy you have, how much passion you have, and are you in the mood or not in the mood. When it comes to prayers, of course, the recommended, the mandatory prayers, the five daily prayers, that does not depend on your mood. That you have to do. That's an obligation. That's like having, you know, the three meals every day, or at least two meals every day. You can't say, I'm not in the mood to have breakfast or lunch. Who's not in the mood to have breakfast or lunch? You have to have breakfast or lunch and dinner sometimes. The five daily prayers are a must. But the rest, that depends on you. There's a hadith that says, إِنَّ لِلْقَلْبِ إِقْبَالٌ وَإِدْبَارٌ. That the heart, you know, it has good moods and it has bad moods. If you're in a good mood, if you feel spiritual, take advantage of it. Do prayers. Do recommended prayers. Take advantage of it. And if you're not in the mood, don't force yourself. You don't need to force yourself to do the recommended prayers. That is not a must. In fact, there's narrations that say don't force yourself to do recommended prayers. Because when you do and you're not up to it, you know, you're tired, you're sleepy, you're not up to it, and you force yourself, you begin to hate that salah. You begin to hate that worship. It becomes a drag. Right? So don't force it. I like to have my children pray with me when I pray. But only when they're in the mood. When they're not too busy in playing. When they're not, you know, when I have their attention and I could get them to come and pray and I'll encourage them to come and pray, I'll get them to pray. But when I tell them to pray and they don't, of course my kids are young. I mean, we're talking about 6 and below. If they're not in the mood, I'm not going to force it on them because I don't want them to hate salah. I want them to grow up liking salah, enjoying it. So I'm not going to force them at that age. At that age. Thus, yes, we do have a lot of recommended prayers. But at the same time, we have quantity, but at the same time, we have quality. Pray the recommended prayers when you feel like it, when you're in the mood. Don't force it on you. Salah ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, one day he told his companions, he told them that there was a man that got his Christian neighbor to become a Muslim. And then, after he helped him convert to Islam, he got him to leave Islam. How? He said one day, you know, this Muslim neighbor, he spoke to his Christian friend. He spoke to him, he convinced him that Islam is the right religion. The Islamic beliefs are the right beliefs. Now that he convinced him, now that his Christian friend converted to Islam, he went to him the next day, early in the morning, before Fajr. He woke him up and he told him, let's go to the mosque, we need to pray the morning prayers. Told him, okay, he got dressed and he went to the mosque, you know, in the middle of the night, before the morning prayers. They went, they waited. He told them, you know, we have a couple of minutes before the morning prayers, let's pray Salatul Layl. They prayed Salatul Layl. They waited until it was sunrise. Until Fajr. They prayed Fajr together. The Christian man who had just converted to Islam, he wanted to get up and leave. He told him, no. It's discouraged to sleep from Fajr till sunrise. It's very makruh. So we have to stay awake. Let's stay and pray or recite Quran. He got him to stay and recite Quran. When it was sunrise, he told him, what's the rush? You're going to go home and sleep? Let's stay in the mosque and recite Quran. Let's hold the tasbih and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he got him to stay until it was close to noon. Told him, you know, it's not worth going back home because noon prayer is in a couple of minutes. So let's stay for Dhuhr. They stayed for Dhuhr. He told him, listen, Asr is in about an hour and something. It's in about an hour and a half. So as might as well, let's just stay till Asr. He got him to stay till Asr. After Asr, he told him, listen, we haven't had anything to eat, right? From morning till now. So as might as well, let's make the intention of fasting. Let's make the intention of fasting, and what's the point of having lunch? So they made the intention of fasting. He told them, let's wait till Maghrib. I mean, we're not going to go home and eat, right? So let's just stay till Salat al-Maghrib. They stayed till Salat al-Maghrib. After that, he told them, Isha and Zajinab, in about an hour, they stayed till Salat al-Isha, and then they went back home. This man was exhausted. By the time that he went back home, he needed someone to carry him back to his house. When he dropped him off, you know, when the two neighbors, the Muslim and the new Muslim, the Christian, the former Christian, they went back home, his Muslim neighbor told him, so should I wake you up tomorrow, right before Fajr? Told him, listen, I'm sick of being a Muslim and I went back to being a Christian. Because if this is Islam, forget about it. Forget about it. I do not want to be a Muslim. You see, Imam al-Sadiq, this is a true story. Imam al-Sadiq then tells his companions, don't be like this person. He got his neighbor to become a Muslim, and then he got him to abandon Islam. He ruined all of his work. Don't be like this person. You see, Islam is not just about quantity. Prayers, 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 one after the other. Or fasting every day, worshiping all the time. No, Islam is about quality. It's the quality of your worship. It's the quality of your dua. It's the quality of the recitation of your Qur'an. Islam doesn't tell you to recite Qur'an 5 hours non-stop, as if it's a marathon, as if there's a race. No. There's quality. Sometimes 10 minutes of the recitation of the Qur'an, beautiful recitation, by understanding what you're reading, is more valuable than reading an hour of Qur'an without understanding, without having a clue of what's being recited, what is being said. Salla ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Some say Islam looks for quantity. How? They say Islam says bear children. Produce. Produce children. As if we're rabbits. Just have as many children as possible. Where? They said, Rasulullah said. Rasulullah states, تَنَاكَحُوا تَنَاسَلُوا فَإِنِّي أُبَاهِي بِكُمُ الْأُمَمَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَلَوْ بِالصَّقْطِ. Rasulullah says, marry and produce. I will be proud of you on the Day of Judgment. I'll be proud of your numbers. Even if there's miscarriages, I'll be proud of them too. In another hadith, Rasulullah says, produce and have either Rasulullah or one of the Ahlul Bayt. Why? لِيُكْثُرُوا مِنْ قَوْلِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So that the word لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ will spread on the face of this earth. And another hadith, خَيْرُ نِسَاء أُمَّتِي الْوَلُودِ الْوَدُودِ. That the best women in my nation are those that are childbearing, that produce children. They're the best women in my nation. So some say that childbearing, let's produce as many children as possible. I was of this opinion. Formerly, I was of this opinion that Islam is against childbirth. Not haram, but highly discourages childbirth, and that we are recommended to have as many children as possible. And this is the reading of a lot of people. However, after taking a close look at these ahadith, you know, looking at their context, where are these hadith coming from? What is the background? We come up with a different conclusion if we analyze correctly. You see, these hadith were being stated at a time when Islam was still fragile. Muslims were still outnumbered. Muslims were a handful. They were a minority, a very small minority. Islam needed the greatest number of people as possible, greatest number of followers. Islam needed numbers. Islam needed followers. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some ask, you know, why didn't Rasulullah fight Abu Sufyan? Why didn't he fight Muawiyah? Why didn't he fight Yazid? But Imam Hussein fought them. Why? Because Islam was still fragile. Islam needed numbers. Islam was too fragile to have fights and arguments and wars during the days of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But then at the time of Imam Hussein, when Islam had spread, there were good numbers. It was time to differentiate between the true believers and the hypocrites. Thus, when we take a look at these narrations, we see that they come from this sort of context, that Islam needed numbers. That is why Islam says, produce, make numbers, make children. You know, sometimes we have to look at the context of certain ahadith, the time and place. The time and place play a major role. Today, there are some scholars, there are some mujtahids in the Hawza, in the Islamic seminary, that believe in the time and place, the theory of time and place, al-zaman wal-makan. The certain narrations, we have to contextualize them. We have to look at what time and what place that these narrations come out of. And then we decide. Perhaps some narrations are not applicable at all times and all places. Let me give you an example. For men, it is recommended to put on henna, right? On their beards and on their hair. And something that this law is applicable to all times. While we have a hadith by Imam Ali alayhi salam, we have, you know, contextual support. Imam Ali alayhi salam was asked, why don't you put henna? He didn't put henna. He was asked, why don't you put henna? He said, no. He said, because it was recommended to put henna at a time in which Muslims were outnumbered. There were very few, and many of them were old. This occurred when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi performed Umrah, year 7 perhaps, after Hijrah. He went into Mecca while Mecca was still controlled by Quraysh. And they would spy on Rasulullah. They wanted to see him, to see his followers. You know, they wanted to see how many numbers are they? What are their capabilities if we were to attack them? Can we attack them? Do they have big numbers, small numbers? Are they young? Are they old? So Rasulullah told his companions, especially the elders, to dye their beards. Why? So that they look what? So that they look younger. And obviously, when you look younger, you look stronger, more powerful. Rasulullah wanted to scare his enemies. Wanted to scare Quraysh. So he had them dye their beards and dye their hairs. Another ruling that the time and place has an issue. In Safa and Marwa, for those of you that have been to Hajj and Umrah, there's a part where people have to jog. Men have to jog. Have you seen it? You have to jog. There's two green lights, or there's one big green light. You have to jog. Why? Some historians say that Rasulullah purposely, he made his followers jog in that area. Why? Because Quraysh, they were spying on the Muslims. Rasulullah wanted them to jog. You know, when you jog, when you see a group of men jogging, they look what? They look strong. They look powerful. They look athletic. That would scare them. So Rasulullah told his companions to jog in that area because they were being watched. They look more powerful, more athletic. Right? So some things we have to look at the context. At what time, at what place? Like today, for example. Today, the Muslims, mashallah, we're in big numbers. Islam is the second largest religion in the world. Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world. We have lots of Muslims across the world. Is it still recommended to bear a lot of children and to produce a lot of children? I don't know. If we have big numbers, what if the big numbers are harmful? Like in some countries, where they lack resources. Having a lot of children will do damage, will do harm more than good. Is it still recommended to have a lot of children? Is it still more is better? Quality, quantity is more is better? Or how about in some countries where, you know, raising children becomes a challenge, becomes a difficulty, like here in the West. Raising children here in the West, it's a difficulty. We all know that. We grew up in the West. We saw how much of a challenge it is to grow up in the West and protect your faith, protect your children, not fall into temptation. That is tough. Raising children in the West is a major challenge. It's a major jihad. Is it still recommended to have a lot of children in the West? I don't know. Thus, we can't just say quantity is better. The more the merrier. No, we have to contextualize. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. On the contrary, we see that Islam concentrates on quality, not on quantity. We just have to reread certain things, reanalyze certain things, and we will see that Islam looks for a quality. Islam is not just about numbers. The more the merrier. No, Islam is about quality. For example, in Islam, we believe that it's the intention that counts. It's not about the action, it's about the intention. In a hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَلَا يَنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ أَعْمَالِكُمْ. That Allah looks to your hearts, not to your actions. Islam doesn't care about the quantity of the action. Islam looks at the intention. The intention behind that action. Was it a good intention or no? Let the action be small. Let it be a small deed. But if the intention was big, the intention was solid, was a good intention, that's what matters. You know, when Imam Ali alayhi salam, he donated his ring in Salah, the famous story, I'm sure you've all heard it. There's some historians that came and analyzed what was the value of the ring of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Some say it was the value of 300,000 dinars. It was the value of the entire revenue of Iraq back then. And Iraq was a very rich country back then. It was worth so much. You know, that's silly. You know why? First of all, would Imam Ali alayhi salam wear a ring that has a value of 300,000 dinars? You think Imam Ali would spend so much on a ring? That's one. Two, it's not about the amount. It's not about how much that ring had a value and a cost. It was the intention. This beggar was ignored by all of the Sahaba in the mosque except Imam Ali alayhi salam. It was the value of the intention, not of the action. It was the intention of Imam Ali alayhi salam. It was the thought. Right? You know, some people they build huge mosques. You know, but they do it to show off. Doesn't matter. You could build the largest mosque in Canada or in North America or in America. But if your intention, there's something wrong with your intention, you're doing it to show off, you could spend millions and it doesn't matter. And you can build a mosque that's the size of an apartment, but you did it with a sincere intention. That's what matters. During the days of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, when he built Quba, Masjid Quba, there were hypocrites that went and built another mosque, just as beautiful, just as large. The Quran condemns that mosque. That mosque could be very beautiful, could be very large, but the Quran condemns that mosque. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet, go and demolish that mosque. Go and demolish it. Because that mosque was not built with pure intentions. It was built out of competition. They were trying to compete with Masjid Quba. Rasulullah went and demolished that mosque. That mosque was called Masjid Dharar, the Masjid of competition. It was destroyed because of the intention. And Masjid Quba was recognized because it was built on solid foundations. لَمَسْجِدٌ أُسِّسَ عَلَى التَّقْوَى مِنْ أَوَّلِ يَوْمٍ أَحَقُّ أَن تَقُومَ فِيهِ. the Masjid of Quba, it was built on solid foundations, on piety. Right? So it's the intention. It's about quality, it's not about quantity. Another example, we have in Islam, we have narrations that say to think, to contemplate for 1 hour is greater than the worship of 70 years. 70 years. What does that tell you? That tells you that it's quality, not quantity. You could worship for 70 years, it could be meaningless if it doesn't come with thought, if it doesn't come with belief, if it doesn't come with understanding. If it doesn't come with understanding, it's just a bunch of exercise. You stand, sit, bow, prostrate. It's a bunch of exercise. You fast, you're going on a diet if it doesn't come with understanding. The hadith says, تَفَكُّرُ السَّاعَةَ خَيْرٌ مِّنْ عِبَادَةِ سَبْعِينَ سَنَةً. Just to think and contemplate for 1 hour is better than the worship of 70 years. Think. Think about Allah's creations. Think about why Allah created you. Why did He create us? Why? What's the purpose? He could have not created me. What would have happened? But He created me. And He gave me all of these gifts. He gave me a mind, a heart, my organs, my hands, my feet, my eyes. He gave me logic. He gave me reason. He gave me so much. For what? For me just to eat and drink and sleep, and that's it? That's it? Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created me for a greater purpose, for a higher purpose, to serve, to produce, to achieve, to do something, to touch people's lives, to leave marks on people's lives, positive marks, to affect people's lives, to benefit people. Think! Thinking for an hour, thinking of why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, what's the mission, what's the goal of this life, it's better than 70 years of meaningless worship. الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا. Those who remember Allah while standing and sitting. وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِنْ. And while they lie down. وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And they think about the creation of the earth and the skies. رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Oh Allah, You did not create all of this in vain and without a reason, without a purpose. There's a purpose behind this life. There's an aim, an objective. It's astonishing to say that all of this came by coincidence. And life has no ambition. And this is the end. This is the end. After we die, there's nothing. It's all about this life. These people have not thought. These people have not contemplated. They've not given this life enough thought. Sallallahu alayhi wa Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So is Islam about quantity? The more the merrier? Is Islam about just numbers? Or is it about quality? We also believe that one scholar is more valuable than 70 worshippers. عَالِمٌ وَاحِدْ أَفْضَلْ مِنْ سَبْعِينَ عَابِدٍ. This is a hadith. One scholar is more valuable than 70 worshippers. Why? Because these 70 worshippers, when you worship, you're only benefiting whom? Who benefits from your worship? People? The community? Your family and friends and neighbors? No, you're the only one that benefits. You only get to go to paradise. That's it. But a scholar benefits everyone. People benefit from a scholar. People are guided. People are touched. People learn from a scholar. People are inspired by scholars. That is why one scholar is more valuable than 70 worshippers. It's about the quality. It's like that companion of Yunus alayhi salam. Prophet Yunus, when he called his tribe to his faith and religion, they didn't listen to him. In fact, they kept on harming him. They kept on abusing him to the point that Yunus alayhi salam was fed up. He asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring his wrath and punishment upon his people. Allah answered his prayer. He said, tell them that within 3 days Allah will punish them. The first day the sky will turn yellow. The second day the sky will turn red. On the third day the sky will turn black. And if the sky turns black, I will punish all of them. Yunus alayhi salam, he lets them know and he leaves. He only had two companions. Yunus alayhi salam only had two companions. One was a regular person, a layman. Just a regular person. The other was a scholar, a alim. When he decided to leave, he told his companions, I'm leaving. Who's coming with me? The layman told him, I'll come with you. The scholar said, I'm not leaving. I'm staying here. He told him, but you will be punished. Along with everyone else. When the wrath comes, it comes for everyone. He said, no, I'm staying. He stayed. Yunus left. On the first day, the sky turns yellow. They realized that Yunus was what? He was telling the truth. He was not lying. They came to him. They came to his house. They saw that he had left. The second day, the sky turned red. Yunus was not to be found. They went to his two companions. One of them was gone. There was one left. The scholar was still there. They came to him. Where's Yunus? He said, he left. Didn't he warn you? He told you that Allah was going to punish you, but you didn't listen. They told him, but do something. Do something. He said, there's nothing that I could do. I'm not a prophet. I'm not a messenger of Allah. I don't have any miracles. They told him, but do something. If tomorrow the sky turns black, we're all doomed. He said, I can't do anything, but you can. There's one thing that you could all do. What? Seek forgiveness from Allah. Repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Repent sincerely. Go out in the desert. All of you, separate the women from the children. Separate the mothers from their small infants. And let everyone beg and cry. Perhaps Allah can have His mercy on you. And indeed, they did. They went out in the desert and they began worshipping, crying, repenting, seeking forgiveness. The skies cleared up and Allah removed His wrath. Because of whom? Not a prophet. Because of a scholar. One scholar. All it took was one scholar. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, ulama ummati afdalu min anbiya bani Israel. The scholars of my nation are better, not the same, better than the prophets of Bani Israel. One scholar can sometimes be greater than a prophet. Why? Because of what he achieves, of what he does. So it's not about numbers, my dear friends. It's not about numbers. Salah ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Another example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent one Quran. Just one. He didn't need to send several books, several gospels, several revelations. No, all it took was one Quran. And that Quran was enough. It's eloquent. It's a miracle in itself. It's full of guidance. It's about the quality of this book, not quantity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have sent us 1,000 books. But all it took was one book, the Qur'an. And look at it today. Till today, it's an everlasting miracle. It still gives us guidance. It still gives us inspiration till today. Another example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent 12 imams. That's it. To their previous nations, He sent them so many prophets, 124,000 prophets. But to this nation, all He needed was 12 imams. We didn't need in the hundreds, we didn't need in the thousands, because these 12 valuable imams were enough. They did the job. They served the purpose. They delivered the message. And we're living off of their achievements, off of their teachings and their guidance. Till today, alhamdulillah, we didn't need any more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, He tells us, that how many of few people they defeated, how many few numbers defeated big numbers. Sometimes all it takes is a few dedicated people to become victorious and to achieve. كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قليلة غلبت فئة كثيرة بإذن الله والله مع الصابرين. You know, in the beginning, the first days of Islam, people were, you know, they were afraid. They would say, we're outnumbered. How could we fight? In the Battle of Badr, they were only 313. While the Mushrikeen, they were 1,000. How can 313 people defeat 1,000? Allah tells them, كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِئَةً كَثِيرًا. There are so many small numbers that defeated big numbers. وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. And Allah is with those that are patient. It requires patience. 20 people that are patient, that work diligently, hard work, it pays off. They'll do a better job than 1,000. Look at it, wherever you go. It's not about numbers. It's not about the quantity, it's about the quality. Look at this majlis, mashallah. There's a group of dedicated people, group of dedicated young men. They're not a lot, they're just a handful. If they could put on a successful program together and have a lot of youth come together on the nights of Ashura, it takes a couple of people, a handful of people. Dedicated, patient, persevering. And it puts on a successful event. In the name of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, in the name of Aba Abdullah. Ya ayyuha an-nabi, harrid al-mu'minin 'ala al-qital. In yakum minkum 20 sabirun yaghlibu 200. Oh, the Prophet, tell your followers, if you have 20 men that are patient, that are strong, that have perseverance, they can defeat 200. They can defeat 200. وَأَنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ مِعَةٌ يَغْلِبُوا أَلْفًا مِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Or you could have 100 that are patient, they could defeat 1,000. They could defeat 1,000. So it's not about just numbers. We believe in Islam. Another example. We believe that there's a hadith that the prayers, the two rak'ah of a married person is equivalent to what? To the prayers of a bachelor person, of a bachelor, who would have to pray 70 units. A married person prays two rak'ah, it's equivalent to 70 units, 70 rak'ah, of a bachelor. It's not about quality of how much you pray. It's about who prays. You see, when you're married and you pray, this person is protected. This person is disciplined. This person has a stable life. He can concentrate better on his salah when he's married. When you're not married, you don't have that concentration. Your mind is everywhere, right? You have to think of a lot of things. But when you're married, you're stable, you're comfortable, you're satisfied, you have a stable life, your salah will count more. Your salah will be rewarded more. ركعتان يصليهما متزوج خير من 70 ركعة يصليهما أعزب. Regarding the people of the cave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the story, He says that people were guessing how many they were. سَيَقُولُونَ ثَلَاثَةٌ رَابِعُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ. Some will say the people of the cave, that, you know, they were mentioned in the Quran. An entire chapter is mentioned after them. Surah Al-Kahf. An entire chapter, right? How many were they? You would assume they were 100 youth. They were 50 youth. They were, no. Wasn't their quantity, wasn't their numbers. سَيَقُولُونَ ثَلَاثَةٌ رَابِعُهُمْ كَلْبُ. They will say that there were three, there were only three, and the fourth was their dog. وَيَقُولُونَ خَمْسَةٌ سَادِسُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ. Some will say, no, there were five, and the dog was the sixth. رَجْمًا بِالْغَيْبِ. وَيَقُولُونَ سَبْعَةٌ وَثَامِنُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ. Some will say, no, there were seven, and the dog was the eighth. قُلْ رَبِّي أَعْلَمُ بِعِدَّتِهِمْ مَا يَعْلَمُهُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ. Say, Allah knows their numbers. What I understand from this verse is that don't ask about how many they were. Ask about what they did, what they achieved. They weren't mentioned in the Quran because they were a big number. No. It's not because they were a big number. It's because of what they did. Their action was big, not their numbers. Their numbers weren't big. My dear brothers and sisters, don't be deterred by numbers. You're not a big number, doesn't matter. You gather on a Thursday night, you're five people, that's fine. These five people, they, you know, they have a huge value in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because these five people could have been somewhere else. But they gathered to recite Dua Kumail, to pray, to recite Quran. These five people are enormous in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it's about the quality. It's not about the quantity. Don't be deterred by numbers. Just because you have big numbers doesn't mean anything. Muslim ibn Aqil had thousands of people praying behind him when he entered Kufa, didn't he? Where were they? Where were they? When he fought by himself. He had big numbers. There were quality, there were quantity. But where was the quality? Who was there to defend Muslim ibn Aqil? Look at Jews today. Jews across the world. How many Jews are there in the world? How many would you say? 10 million? 20 million? I don't think they're more than 20 million. 50 million maximum. 20 million maximum. Look at what they're doing. Look at how powerful they are. Is it because of their numbers? Jews are abundant in their numbers? No. They're not abundant in their numbers. But look at how powerful they are. They have the most powerful lobby in the world. They control universities, campuses, college professors, the media, magazines. Wherever you go, they're in control. They don't have big numbers. They don't control with their numbers. They control with their power, with the effect that they have, with their money, with their influence. And we Muslims, we're 2 billion. And look at where we are. Look at where we are today. We're ridiculed. We're made fun of. They ban us from wearing hijab. They ban us from wearing niqab. And we're 2 billion. What have we done? Is it about numbers? If it's about numbers, we're a lot more. We outbeat everyone else. But what have we done? Let's learn. Salu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. You know, there's some Muslims, they should learn a lesson. All they look for is quantity, numbers. Let's gather numbers. It's all about the numbers. But as for the quality, no. Who cares about the quality? Who cares about the quality? As long as we have big numbers. Let's have a lot of satellite channels. You know, I remember just 10 years ago or 15 years ago, there weren't any satellite channels. There were no Shi'i satellite channels. 15 years ago. Today, mashallah, we have over 50 satellite channels in English, in Arabic, in Farsi, in Urdu, in Swahili, in Turkish, in, I don't know, in so many languages. In so many languages, we have satellite channels. Every day now there's a group that wants to start a satellite channel. Now in English, we have maybe 3 or 4. Every day you'll hear a group that wants to start a satellite channel. Why? Is it just about random numbers? No, if you had quality, I could understand. Some channels, if they have the quality, I get it. But a lot of these channels, unfortunately today, one of our problems is that we Shia, we have so many satellite channels, and a lot of them are what? Poor quality. Poor programming. Poor lectures. Just, it's very poor. For others, where to see these programs, it's an embarrassment. Why? Why have 50 satellite channels when we could have 5, but of great quality? Of great quality. Whether it's in Arabic or Farsi or Urdu or other channels. Another issue is Islamic centers. In some cities, they don't have any Islamic center. Or maybe they have one. I've been to some cities, there's only one Islamic center. People there, they have only one choice, one option. They only could go to that Islamic center. They don't have any other options. There's one speaker, one majlis, one place to go to. No other options. And there's other cities, there's so many Islamic centers. You have so many options to choose from. Now sometimes these Islamic centers are needed. you know, it's a very big city and you can't commute, there's traffic, you know, people are scattered everywhere, that's fine. But when you're in one area, and I'm not talking about a specific community, I see this in a lot of places. In one area, you have this center, that center, this center, this center. And you have 10 people here, 20 people here, 15 people here. And they're scattered everywhere, they're divided everywhere. Why? Why? Just because we want to have big numbers of Islamic centers, we want to say that we have 20 Islamic centers in this city. We have 30 Islamic centers in the city. Why? Instead of having one place. You know, and I wish that all of these places, they had quality. And it's, no, they don't have quality. It's just, there's a bunch of places. There's no quality. You know, for me, a quality place is not in the building. It might be an old building. It doesn't have a qubba and the minarets. It doesn't have the dome. No, you know what, to me, what a successful Islamic center is? If it has youth, if it has you people, people like you. If that Islamic center is full of youth, it's a successful Islamic center. But if you come and the youngest person is 60 years old, with all due respect to the ones that are 60 years old, you know, that's not a successful Islamic center. That's not a successful Husseiniyah. That's not a successful mosque. A successful mosque is the one that brings in youth, that caters to the youth, that deals with youth problems, youth issues. That's a successful Islamic center. But we, unfortunately, we're always thinking about the quantity. Let's start an Islamic center, and then let's see how it goes. What kind of quality, what kind of programs we could have. No, first think about the programs. At our Islamic centers, do we have interfaith programs? Do we invite Christians and Jews to attend our events? Do we invite a Christian priest or a Jewish rabbi and we have, you know, a dialogue and a conversation? Do we do that? Most of our centers we don't. Do we have intrafaith? Do we bring in scholars from other schools of thought? Do we welcome them into our Islamic centers and we have such events, we have dialogue, we have debates, we have conversations? These are the programs and events that youth are looking for. But to open an Islamic center and have traditional programs just like others, and you go into a place and it's empty of youth, you aren't doing a service for Islam. We are not doing a service for Islam, believe me. We're just increasing the numbers. We're not doing anything quality-wise. Even when it comes to majalis, you see majalis here, a majlis here, a majlis there. And it's the same thing, we're only dividing the community. We're not uniting, and it's not about the quality. There are some majalis also, and I have to say this, you know, there's some places, and this happens in all cultures and in all countries as well. They bring in the reciters and the speakers who draw the biggest crowds, right? This person has a nice voice, let's bring him. This reciter is famous, let's bring him. Because they bring in the largest crowds. Quantity, right? Well, what about the quality? What about the quality of the people that you're bringing? Is it just the masses? Are you bringing the educated crowd? Which kind of crowd are you trying to draw? You see, my dear friends, Islam tells us about quality. It's not about quantity. It's not just about sheer numbers. صلى على محمد وآل محمد. At Badr, at the Battle of Badr, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وآله, all he needed was how many? 313. The mushrikeen were 1,000, yet these 313 were able to defeat those 1,000. Even though they were outnumbered by what? What was the ratio? 3-1. 3-1. Yet the Muslims achieved. Because they had quality members, they had quality soldiers. They had Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. They had al-Hamza. They had others. Right? Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam, ajjar Allahu ta'ala farajah, all he needs is 313. He doesn't need an army of a million. He doesn't need an army of hundreds of thousands. For God's sake, all he needs is 313. one of the reasons why the Imam is not reappearing is because he doesn't have the 313. For God's sake, it's just 313, yet the Imam still doesn't have them. Whenever those, whenever that number is completed, he has the right amount of followers, he'll come out. And we all claim to be followers of Imam Mahdi alayhi salam. How many Muslims are there? How many Shia are there? Out of all of these followers of Ahl Bayt, we don't have 313? That's a shame. That's a shame. The Imam, all he needs is just 313. Because it's about quality. It's about the quality of these men. Imam Hussein alayhi salam began a revolution with how many men? With just 72 men. Look at what he did. It was just a couple of hours. The Battle of Ashura. You know, when we think about the Battle of Ashura, we imagine it to be a couple of days or a couple of weeks. It was just less, it was less than 6 or 7 hours. Have you heard of the Hundred Years' War? In Europe, there was the Hundred Years' War. Who talks about the Hundred Years' War? It took 100 years. But no one remembers the Hundred Years' War. But look at how many people remember this battle that lasted for a couple of hours. From morning till the afternoon. Imam Hussein led the morning prayers with his companions, Salat al-Fajr, and it ended with Salat al-Asr. The Imam prayed it by himself, lying on the battleground. From Salat al-Fajr to Salat al-Asr, that's it. You would think that the Battle of Ashura had millions. All it had was 72 men. Yeah, look at what they did. Look at the remembrance that they left. Look at the revolution that they made. Look at the millions that they've inspired. All it was 72 men. But which kind of men? Habib ibn Mudahir, this great companion, who was a veteran from the Battle of Badr, who fought with Rasulullah, and he also fought with Imam Hussein alayhi salam. This scholar, this huge man like Habib ibn Mudahir. You see, what's beautiful about Karbala and Ashura is everyone participated. Old men participated, Habib ibn Mudahir. Youth participated, Al-Qasim Ali al-Akbar. Young adults and young men participated, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. How old do you think Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was? You know, we imagine Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas to be a 60-year-old man. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas was in his 30s. He was probably 34, 32, 34 years old. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Women participated in the Battle of Ashura, the mother of Wahab, the mother of the 10-year-old child. Little girls participated in the Battle of Ashura, Ruqayya and Sukaina. And among those that participated were infants. Even infants participated in Karbala. This is what makes Karbala, Karbala. Because it's about the quality. It's not about the quantity of the numbers. Imam Hussein alayhi salam could have had 1,000 people, but it wouldn't have had the same effect. There were only 72 men.